At just 10 and 12 years old, my kids were doing calculus. Yes, that's right, calculus. On their own. And second semester calculus at that. I asked them to submit a bid for a small money-earning venture in our family, and they used calculus-type thinking to come up with their answers. The same type of thinking I teach my college students. So what were they thinking exactly, and why? In a previous video, I tossed out a problem based on my kids bidding to earn money to build a bike rack. The lowest bidder would help me build the bike rack and get the money they bid, but the bids they tossed out were crazy and at first seemed to have no logic. $11.11 and $6.67? Why such strange bids? If you haven't watched the previous video, you can find the link in the description, and you can see if you can solve the puzzle yourself before watching this video, where we reveal what my kids were thinking. There are even a couple of hints in the description of the previous video to help you out. So what did my kids do? Well, like many Christians, we had taught our kids the law of tithing, which is to donate 10% of one's income back to God. So each of them picked the smallest value of money for which they would be willing to help build the bike rack. One kid picked $6, the other one picked $10. But both of them wanted that much after they paid tithing, so they had to start doing some math. Each separately thought the same thing, but I'll use the $10 bid as an example. Well, I want $10 after I pay 10% tithing, so I need another 10% of $10, so I need another dollar. But now I have to pay tithing on that dollar, so I need to earn another 10% of that dollar, so 10 cents. But now I need to pay tithing on 10 cents, so I need 10% of 10 cents, so I need a penny. And since our currency doesn't use half pennies anymore, we can stop there. So my son ended up with a bid of $11.11. The one that started with $6 did the same thing, but rounded up at the end to get $6.67. So where is the calculus in all of this? At first it might not seem like calculus, but when mathematicians and other scientists have a hard time calculating a number directly, they find a way to sneak up on that value instead. One way to do this is with a sequence of numbers. In the process of figuring out the final bid, one of my kids started with $10, then $1, then 10 cents, then one penny, and he could have kept going. This is the first sequence in the problem. But my kid wasn't trying to sneak up on a value less than a penny. He was trying to reach a value that is the sum of the sequence. This is what mathematicians call a series. A series is the sum of a sequence. Both of these sequences my kids came up with could have continued indefinitely, and the series created from their sequences could have had infinitely many terms. This is where we actually get into the realm of calculus. There is an infinite sequence. Does it creep up to one particular number? Creeping up to a number needs to be fleshed out a little, but it is the intuitive idea of convergence. Can a sum of infinitely many values, that is, an infinite series, have a finite value? If so, when does it have a finite value? And if it does have a finite value, what is that value? In the vocabulary of calculus, we would ask if the infinite series converges, and if so, to what value does it converge? In practice, we often do what my kids did. Add up the values of the series until we get an answer that's accurate enough for our needs. Mathematicians have a name for the sum of the first portion of a series. It's called a partial sum of the series. We usually use computers to help us do the calculations and find partial sums, but that makes it sound much simpler than it really is. We need the math to make sure our series will actually get close to the number we want, and some way to know when we're within a certain error of that true value. There's an entire field of mathematics called numerical analysis that's dedicated to getting computers to solve problems for us in this way. The math of adding up infinitely many things to get a finite value can be mind-bending. It might seem impossible. It was for the ancient Greeks. They developed several paradoxes based on the math of adding up infinitely many things. The most famous are paradoxes developed by Zeno. Here's one of Zeno's paradoxes, called Achilles and the Tortoise. Suppose Achilles starts 10 meters behind a tortoise, but runs 10 times as fast. Zeno argued that Achilles could never catch the tortoise, because after Achilles runs 10 meters, the tortoise moves another meter. And after Achilles runs that meter, the tortoise moves another tenth of a meter. And so it would keep going on and on. There's always another point that Achilles would need to reach before catching the tortoise, and the tortoise will have moved further down the path by the time Achilles reaches that point. In other words, there are infinitely many segments with positive length that Achilles needs to run before he catches the tortoise. And so, he could never catch the tortoise. Of course, the Greeks knew that Achilles could reach the tortoise, and that's what made it a paradox to them. The math says Achilles' distance is the sum of infinitely many positive segments, but Achilles does catch the tortoise pretty quickly. So how can both be true? The trouble the Greeks had was trying to come to grips with the fact that adding up infinitely many positive values can still sum to a finite value. Our notation makes it easy to know exactly how far Achilles would run to reach the tortoise. 10 plus 1 plus 0.1 plus 0.01 plus 0.001, etc. is 11.111 repeating, or 100 divided by 9 meters. But the Greeks did not have such nice numeric notation or the mathematical tools to handle the sum of a converging series. But in modern time, even my 10-year-old was not fazed by an infinite series with a finite value. That's largely because of the decimal notation and decimal meaning he was comfortable with. So yes, it is possible to add up infinitely many values and end up with a finite value, as long as the values become arbitrarily small. But even that is not precise enough. There are several examples of infinite series where the values added become arbitrarily small, but the sum is larger than any finite value. The most famous example is the harmonic series, the sum of the values 1 over n from n equals 1 to infinity. So when will an infinite series of positive values converge to a finite value, and when will it diverge to infinity? That's something my former 10-year-old probably won't be able to understand till he actually takes calculus. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.